Hi, good morning. How have we been doing so far in our campaign? We are now on our fifth Sunday of our Transform 2.0 series, and I hope and pray that even though we are in this unprecedented situation of our time, we continue to hope and pursue the transformation that God wants us to become. And we appreciate our WIN kids for rendering us a special number and a beautiful reminder of how God has wonderfully and intricately created us. Part of the verse they read is in verse 13 to 14 of Psalm 139. For you created me in my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. If you will study human anatomy, you will be amazed on how complicated our body was made. God did not make us just like other creations. We were the only creatures that He breathed on to have life to become living beings. And we were the only created beings that He created in His own image. He did not give this privilege to other creations. And if God did all this for us, isn't just proper to regard this body the way how God put a wonderful work on it? Like a piece of art, when you see a beautifully crafted art piece, you begin to appreciate this beautiful craftsmanship, and all praise to the one who created and made it. And if you have been to a museum where art pieces of known artists are exhibited or displayed, you will notice that people are not allowed to touch it. There's a certain distance people can get near to the art pieces, and this is how they take care of them to preserve them. And similarly, we are the masterpiece of God, and we should take care of this body the way it brings honor and glory to God. There was a time when a teacher of the law asked Jesus this question, "Of all the commandments, which is the most important?" And Jesus gave them this answer, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength." The greatest commandment given to us by Jesus Himself is to love God not only with our heart, soul, but of all our being. We have to love Him holistically. And to love Him that is all within us, it includes our body. Paul said in Romans chapter 12, verse 1, he says, "Therefore I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God, and this is your spiritual act of worship." When God requires us to offer our bodies in worship, this means not only a soul and a spirit are important part of our being, but also our body. But someone might think, why would God be interested in my body? It's overweight, it's underweight, wrinkled, achy, impulsive, unattractive, lazy, awkward. So what kind of sacrifice is that? Because in the Old Testament, God demanded a flawless sheep. So you may think that you don't measure up, but hold on. What Paul is saying here is that the offering of our body is not the offering of our bodily looks, but our bodily behavior. In the Bible, the body is not significant because of the way it looks, but because of the way it acts. The body is given to us to make visible and reflect the beauty of Christ. So having said that, this is one of the key areas of our lives that we need transformation. Because sometimes we tend to adopt the culture in the society that we live in, living in a lifestyle that has a negative effect on our health, and eventually damaging our body. And the moment I got this assignment, you know, to share about this topic, my wife immediately looked at my belly. Yes, I myself also need this transformation. And you know why I ended up with this beer belly? Not because I like to drink beer, but I have a lot of excuses not to eat right and to exercise. Especially during this pandemic where we all stay at home. With all the baking, experimental cooking, convenience of food deliveries, so eating really becomes a factor in getting some extra unwanted weight. You know, my wife usually has a routine daily, and she will wake up at a certain time in the morning to exercise. And she would normally wake me up and ask me to join her, but I always have excuses. My wife controls what she eats while I eat until it is finished. Obviously, my wife is really concerned about my health, while I have a lot of excuses not to be concerned about it. But praise God, in the past few months, I was able to go back in my routine of running, watching what I'm eating. Today, I entitled this conversation as Our Body Matters. So we will learn in this conversation how our body matters to God and how He has put so much premium on our body. So if our body matters to God, it should also matter to us. And our passage today can be found on 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 12 to 20. And if there is one thing I would like all of us to remember in this conversation is this, that God's right design of our bodies deserves our right regard. So when we have this realization of how important our body is to God, when we have the right view of how our body is to the Lord, that Christ has done so much work on it, you know, and how good and strong, healthy body is important to fulfill the purpose of God in our lives, for our family, to our loved ones, and to the people who depend on us. This should give us reason, motivation to start looking after our body and treat it the right way it deserves. And this is also an appreciation and gratitude of what Christ has done for us. You know, this passage may be talking about sexual immorality as a title on your Bible. And in few verses a bit, in verse 9 and 10, there are different activities that Paul mentioned there. These activities were clearly described by Paul as sins. And if you practice all these and not turn away from them, Paul said, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. But there is one thing I would like all of us to notice, that though these activities has spiritual implications, we cannot deny the fact that these habits, practices, has negative effects or implication on health, on our body. And since our body is the instrument of God that God uses in different ministries He entrusted to us, would it make sense to say that if our body is healthy, we can accomplish more and perform better the work in the kingdom of God that He entrusted to us? That we can better take care and provide for our family? One of the excuses they were using to justify the indulgences to their physical cravings is in verse 12. It says, everything is permissible for me. Going back a few verses, we can read how Paul was describing the way of life in the city, in the communities. In chapter 6, verse 9, Paul said, do you not know that the wicked will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexual immoral, idolaters, adulterers, male prostitutes, homosexual offenders, nor thieves, the greedy, the drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. These were practices and activities they were indulging themselves in. And if you notice, these are the activities to fulfill the appetite of pleasure. And some members of the church in Corinth used to be like what Paul just described. You know, church in Corinth was one of the church that Paul established, which you can find in the accounts of Acts in chapter 18. Paul in his teachings constantly remind the people that Christ has set us free. And we can find that in Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, that we have been called to live in freedom and don't get tied up again in the slavery of the law. That we are not under law anymore, but under grace. And by grace we have been saved through faith, not by our works. Here clearly they distorted the message of Paul on liberty, which is moral law being of no use and not binding, because faith alone is necessary for salvation. And they are doing what they are doing because of this slogan. And we know we call it excuses. You know, I can do anything I want. I can sleep with whoever I want. I can eat as much as I want. I can drink as much as I like. But Paul said, not everything you are engaged in is beneficial. And there are certain things you can do, but That doesn't mean it is beneficial to you and to the people around you. And there are things you enjoy, but it doesn't mean it brings good to you. Some people in Corinth, church in Corinth, were engaged in having sex with prostitutes. So Paul was saying that sex is good, and it is a gift of God to married couple. And it doesn't mean you can sleep with whoever you want to satisfy your desires, your sexual desires. You can drink, but to the point of getting drunk. Doctors will say that excessive drinking has negative effect on your physical health. Eating is good, but excessive eating is not good for your health either. Yes, you can do anything, but remember this, Paul said, not everything brings benefit to you and even to the people around you. And Paul also refuted the excuses by saying, I will not be mastered by anything. And if there is something that you are doing right now that you cannot give up, you are enslaved to that, because whatever overcomes a man, to that he is enslaved, and that he becomes his master. Paul calls it slavery, but in our time today, we can call it addiction. And there are many types of addiction: drug addiction, food addiction, chocolate addiction, video game, gambling, alcohol addiction, sexual addiction, you name it. And the term behavioral addiction, according to Wikipedia, it refers to a compulsion to engage in a natural reward, which if a person is engaged to these activities, they feel some kind of rewarding experience. You start trying things and continue to do things because you feel some level of satisfaction. And there is no person that will say that when he started to engage on some of these activities, they want to be addicted to it. There's a process. You taste it, you like it, you come back again, you were satisfied, and you keep coming back because it's rewarding, until you don't realize or notice that you are hooked to it. If you put yourself under the authority of these activities, Paul was saying, it will bring you no good benefits. And once you are under the authority of these activities, it will enslave you, or you will become addicted to it. You ask a person who wants to quit smoking, people who wants to quit gambling or drinking, they will tell you that it's not easy to get out of this. It is possible, but it's not easy. And if you Google and type overcoming addiction, within 34 seconds, it can give you 22 million sites where you can find help and information on the topic. So people are trying to get out of this, but it's tough. It's challenging. Institutions have set up rehabilitation centers to help people who are hooked to certain addiction and want to get out of it. And Paul was saying here, I am free to do certain things, but I'm not going to let myself be dependent on it. And Paul knows the power when someone is under the power of certain things. Similarly, when we put ourselves under the power of God and believe in Jesus, Jesus said in John chapter 14 that we will do the works that Jesus have been doing, and we will do even greater things than this. And the second excuse of the Christians in Corinth to justify the behavior is this famous slogan in their city: food for the stomach and the stomach for food, but God will destroy them both. And they're using this slogan to justify their indulgence in sexual immorality, food being a necessity, but it's also pleasurable. Same with sex. Sex is a necessity for procreation, but it's also pleasurable. For them, these are all temporary, just like food and stomach, that in the end, God will destroy both of them. So why not eat, sleep, and be merry, for tomorrow we die? And in Greek culture, they have this influential Greek philosophy called Stoicism. The Stoic view their body as the prison house of the soul. You know, the body is a tomb. And one philosopher said, I am poor soul shackled to a corpse. And what they are saying actually is this: this body is not important. So they devalue the importance of this body, that whatever you do with this body, whether you deprive it with pleasures of this world or let your body satisfy all the pleasures you can get, it is fine because it is of no moral significance anyway, and certainly does not affect our soul and spirit. So they use this slogan to justify the excessive behavior, drunkenness, sexual immorality, and food. Yes, even food. Because in few chapters after chapter 6 and chapter 8, we can observe that they are even eating food sacrificed to idols. That they don't even care if they are causing someone to stumble because of this behavior. And in chapter 11, verse 21, Paul said, "For as you eat, each of you goes ahead without waiting for anybody else." You know, before the party starts, you start eating, and before it ends, you start packing. So one remains hungry, the other one remains drunk. And most of the time, these pleasurable activities, excessive indulgences that we are putting our body into, get outside of the boundary of which our body is meant to. Sexual immorality, too much drinking, and gluttony or excessive indulgence in food. In our culture today, we are quick to condemn people who are smoking, people who drink too much, but it seems that excessive eating is accepted and tolerated. Many may argue that smoking and drinking leads to many health issues, but the same is true if we overindulge ourselves in food. Food is essential to human survival and is an important aspect of our wellness and means of pleasure and enjoyment. But food is also a cause of many health issues. But how do you know if you are having food issues or overindulging yourself with food? So one way to know is if we need to go shopping because our clothes just simply could not fit in, or we could not fit to our clothes anymore. The someone who says, "We took what we wanted until we no longer wanted what we took." The excess weight that we gain because of this lifestyle can lead to obesity. According to government health website, that global obesity has more than doubled since 1980, and many health professionals calling it as a rising epidemic. And there are many diseases that are associated with obesity. Diabetes, cardiovascular disease, it can lead to heart attacks, strokes, certain type of cancers, and other things. Some insurance companies don't even cover or has limited coverage on some types of illnesses and diseases as they are acquired due to the lifestyle of a person. If you are smoking or drinking, your insurance premium can be higher because they know there are a lot of possible diseases that may come as a result of your habit. And excessive eating, excessive indulgence of about anything is defined by Merriam-Webster dictionary as gluttony. And in the Bible, we can see passages that condemns it. In Proverbs chapter 23, verses 20 to 21, it says, "Do not join those who drink too much wine or gorge themselves to meat, for drunkards and gluttons become poor, and drowsiness clothes them in rags." In Proverbs chapter 28, verse 7, "He who keeps the law is a discerning son, but a companion of gluttons disgraces his father." And in Ezekiel, the Bible says that one of the sins of Sodom was gluttony. In Ezekiel chapter 16, verse 49, it says, "Sodom's sins were pride, gluttony, and laziness, while the poor and needy suffered outside her door." And there's one website, Christianity.com, that written an article about three reasons why church should preach on gluttony. And the obvious reason is health. And let me read what they put on the website, that obesity is the scourge of our times, the black plague of the 21st century. You know, look at an old video clip at City Live in the 1940s. How slim people were. And a second reason why we should teach people about this topic is on the scripture. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 31 says, "Whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God." And the third one is about godliness, that one of the key reasons to overcome gluttony is self-control. which is one of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. You know, some Christians in Corinth indulges themselves in food, drinking, sex, and other activities that they find it pleasurable. And you know, when we indulge on something, we seek for our own pleasure. And not always that when we seek pleasure to please our appetite is necessarily wrong. But our body is not only designed for our own pleasure. Our body is designed for a much higher purpose. So going back to our verse, food for the stomach and stomach for food, but God will destroy them both. And it continues, the body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. When someone designs something, it was designed for an intended purpose. And if you don't use it the way it was intended for, you may encounter a problem along the way. So my brothers and sisters, God's right design of our bodies deserves our right regard. And God designed sex for a man and a woman, between a husband and a wife, for procreation. And God also gave it as a gift which brings a husband and a wife together into a physical union. Use this outside of these boundaries, you get into sexual immorality. Use this outside of these boundaries, you may run into consequential effect of both health and relationship to your husband or to your wife. And it can destroy families. A study shows that if a just married couple, a man and a woman, they are virgins and never had sex before they get married, they will never get sexually transmitted disease for as long as they are together. And you compare this to a man and a woman who gave themselves to multiple sex partners, the chances of getting a sexually transmitted diseases will be very high. And not only that, sexual immorality has a spiritual effect, physical effect. It also has effect in our relationship with our spouses. And there are statistics in America that between 20% to 40% divorces are due to infidelity. And probably you know some people that due to infidelity of the husband and the wife got separated. And the children got caught into this mess, and some of them became rebellious and hurting. So if we use our body to what God did not intend it to, we run into serious issues. So our body is designed for the Lord and not for the activities that fulfills just our desires and bring damage to our body eventually. And Paul here is trying to correct their understanding and hopefully change the way they view their body. That our body is designed to fulfill what God has intended for each one of us to do for His glory. And the next verse, Paul is slowly elevating on how we should view our body in light of what God has done and will be done. In verse 14, Paul said, by His power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and He will raise us also. Paul is talking about that as God raised Jesus from the dead, He will raise us up as well. But the Greek culture made it difficult for the Corinthian Christians to appreciate fully the doctrine of resurrection. Because Greek philosophy taught dualism, which divides human body, a body, they see it as an evil. That's how lowly they look at their body. And soul and spirit, which seen as good. So for them, afterlife is only happening to the soul and not to the body. And this is the reason why in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul had to spend the whole full chapter talking about the resurrection. And Paul in his letter there says, without resurrection, our preaching and our faith will be useless, and there is life after death. Without resurrection, we are the most to be pitied person. Yes, our body will die, but on an appointed time, God will raise us up again, just as God raised Jesus from the dead. And He will raise us up not spiritually, but physically. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16 says, for the Lord Himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. and the dead in Christ will rise first. So the pattern of our bodily resurrection will be the same as Jesus when he was resurrected. His disciples were able to see him, were able to touch him and talk to him. So when Paul said that God raised the Lord Jesus from the dead, he will also raise us. And Paul was elevating the importance of our physical body to the level of significance of Jesus' resurrection. So although our body will go back to ashes after we die, Paul said that it will not remain as that, but God will raise it back again, not with the imperfections and blemishes, but with the body the same as Jesus' glorious body. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 21, Paul said that he will take our weak mortal bodies and change them into glorious bodies like his own, using the same power with which he will bring everything under his control. So don't treat our body as if something that it will not matter in eternity. And Paul continued with this writing, telling them the significance of the physical body. In verse 15, do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? Shall I then take members of Christ and unite them with the prostitute? Never. Because our body is not simply temporary and inferior entity with which we are forced to live until our spirit is liberated when we die. Paul here is now making even stronger the point of the importance of our body with God. That our physical body is a physical extension of Christ himself on earth. Example, look at your body right now. You have feet, you have arms, you have ears, tongue, eyes. Now, would you be willing that one of these parts of your body be cut off from your main body? If not for meaningful reason or medical reason, no way. Because how are you going to see if you don't have eyes? How are you going to hear if you remove your ears? And this is how different parts of our body are important for us to function normally. In the same way that we as part of Christ himself, we are important to him. And if we know that our body is an integral part of Christ's body and an important part of him, Paul asked them, would you take this body and unite it with the prostitute? And Paul used a very strong word, never, over my dead body. So going back to our illustration of our own body, part of loving our body is to protect it from anything that will hurt the body from external elements. You know, when we go out in the beach, we put sunblock on our skin to protect our skin from UV rays because continuous or extensive exposure to this can cause skin cancer. We wear sunglasses to protect our eyes. So in the same way, uniting our body with prostitutes bring harm than good to our body and to our life as a whole. Paul continued in the next verse on what happened if you have physical intimacy with a person, not your spouse. Do you know that he who unites himself with a prostitute is one with her in his body? For it is said, the two shall become one flesh. But he who unites himself with the Lord is one with him in his spirit. Corinth was a major port city where prostitutes are available left and right to service the needs of the sailors and other transients. And you can also find the temple of Aphrodite in Corinth where it employed thousands of prostitutes and sex was part of the worship ritual. And some of the Christians in Corinth were caught up with this. So growing up in this society and culture, you may think that this is normal since it is acceptable in their society. So I find it very challenging for the Christians in Corinth during that time. They probably have trouble seeing sex outside marriage as a big deal because they have seen this as part of their culture and may think that it is normal since everyone is doing it. And Paul used this phrase from Genesis, the two shall become one flesh, which refers to a man and a woman become one flesh when they get married. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 24, For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and they will become one flesh. And Paul here is rejecting the idea that sex is more than just a bodily function. Just like any other appetite, you know, food for the stomach and stomach for food. If I'm hungry, I will eat. If I'm thirsty, I will eat. Because a person who engages to this activity outside of marriage is actually becoming one with her. So it is not only a momentary transaction, but it is sacred. Similarly, when we believe and have given our life to Christ, we become one with Him in spirit. And Paul was saying here that you cannot justify that whatever I do with my body does not have an effect with my connection with God. No, it's all connected. And look at the next verse and what Paul's charge to them after showing them that their body is not just a body. It is a body to be used for the Lord's purpose. It is a body that is a member of Christ's body, an important part of Christ. It is a body that is sacred and is one with Christ. In verse 18, he says, "Flee from sexual immorality. All other sin a man commits are outside his body, but he who sins sexually sins against his own body." And when I read this, I remember the story of Joseph, where he ran away when Potiphar's wife tried to seduce him. And Paul said here, run away. Don't even negotiate. Don't even get curious. Don't even rationalize things. Run. You know, just like Eve in the garden where God had already commanded them not to eat at that fruit. But instead, conversation happened. And we know what happened in the end. So when you have a problem like this, where do you normally get advice to get help? No, normally we look for people who had experience and overcome the problem that they're going through, right? Solomon, who had 1,000 wives and concubines, have this advice in Proverbs chapter 5, verses 7 to 11. Now then, my sons, listen to me. Do not turn aside from what I say. Keep to a path far from her. Do not go near the door of her house, lest you give your best strength to others and your years to one who is cruel. Lest strangers feast on your wealth and your toil and reach another man's house. And at the end of your life, you will groan when your flesh and body are spent. So there will be regret at the end of your life. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12 says, "If you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall." And he continues saying that there is no temptation that seizes you except what is common to man. That God is faithful and He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. And He will provide a way out so you can stand up under it. Paul has singled out this among the many indulgences, fleshly pleasures that the people are engaged, because sexual immorality is a sin that we commit against our own body. This is a sin that does a lot of damage, not only in our relationship and union with Christ. It is also a number one cause of broken marriages, families, and sexually transmitted diseases. And this is the activity where our body is not designed and meant for. And engaging to this activity means putting our body to the very low which God has put so much value. So Paul is not yet finished in his letter, and his next point puts our physical body as sacred and holy. In verse 19, "Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God?" A person who accepted Christ as our Lord and Savior and put our faith in Him, He put His Spirit in our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing our salvation. It means that the Holy Spirit takes residence in us. Now, a temple is a very significant to the believers because a temple is a place of prayer. A temple is a place of worship. A temple is a place of sacrifice, a place of celebration. It is a symbol of God's presence, a place that is revered and should be treated with reverence and respect. There's one time Jesus in John chapter 2, where Jesus went to Jerusalem and when he found people selling cattle, sheep, exchanging money, he got angry. He overturned the tables and scattered all the coins from the money changers. And people at that time were misusing the temple and turned it into a marketplace. They forgot and did not care that the temple is a place of worship and a house of prayer. You know, when Solomon builds a temple, he built it for 7 years. He employed more than 200,000 workers working together to build the temple. You know, the temple was also built using the best materials available at the time. So when you build some structure this big, this beautiful, it is also proper to also maintain it and keep it to its glorious beauty. And there must be some people doing the cleaning, maintaining it, and people who keep this temple up and running. You know, president of the countries have their own official residence. In the U.S., we have the White House as the official residence of the president of the United States. In the Philippines, we have the Malacañang Palace, which house the president of the Philippines. Even here in Singapore, we have the Istana as the official residence of the president of the Singapore. So these are the houses, offices of the leaders of the country to carry out their functions and duties. These are the houses for sure are well taken care of with probably hundreds, if not thousands of people with different jobs and responsibilities to ensure the house is in proper order. It is well guarded and well protected from potential enemy because it is also a symbol of power. So when we view our body as a temple of God, a residence, the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit, we start to change the viewpoint and perspective on the way we look at our body. We now view our body not just as a temporary shelter, not just as a tent or something insignificant, but we see our body as a dwelling place of the Holy Spirit of God. In Acts chapter 1 verse 8 says, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." And in chapter 2, they receive the Holy Spirit and start to share the gospel to thousands of people. So since it is a temple of the Holy Spirit, which houses the Holy Spirit of God, our bodies actually become a base of operation on which God fulfills His purpose through us. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 10 says, "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." You know, we can only do things that God wants us to do for as long as our body is physically healthy and strong. So the more our body is kept clean and healthy, the more God can use us as a base of operation to do good works and fulfill His purpose. So when we abuse our body, when we don't respect it and use it the way that God did not design it to, it delimits our ability on how God can use us for His kingdom. And some Christians in Corinth believe that their body is insignificant in eternity. It doesn't matter what you do about it. And there's a saying that we believe to be true. What we believe to be true translates on how we live. That's why it is important that we understand how we view our body, how God views our bodies. Because if we believe that they are good and valuable in His eyes, we will learn to treat them the right way. Romans chapter 12 verse 2, Paul said, "Do not be conformed any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." And we will only be transformed spiritually, physically, in our relationship with other people, and in other key areas of our lives to the degree of our mind is renewed. And the degree of our transformation that we can get is equal to the degree of how much our mind is renewed. And renewing our minds means replacing this with our thoughts with God's. Thoughts of how we view our body the way society taught us and influenced us into the thoughts of how God viewed the body He gave us. And the next verse tells us in verse 20, "You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body." You know, in verse 12, when Paul wrote the justification that they are using to do what they're doing, they said, "Everything is permissible for me," as if to say that I can do anything I want. But actually, no, you cannot just do anything you want with your body because it does not belong to you. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18 to 19 says, "For you know that God paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors. And it was not paid with mere gold or silver, which lose their value. It was the precious blood of Christ, the sinless, spotless Lamb of God. Not only that God owns us by the mere fact that He created us, He also owns us because He redeemed us. He bought us with a price that nobody can put a price tag on it. In the past, you can free a slave by paying their master at an agreed amount. But God did not pay us with silver or gold, which loses its value, but it was the precious blood of Jesus Christ." Isn't it comforting? We are highly valued by God that He even gave His own begotten Son for us to redeem us. So given that our life is not our own and He bought us with a price, it means that we are stewards of our body. If we are in Christ, our lives, including our body, belong to Him. This gives Him the ultimate authority to tell us what to do and what not to do with our bodies. And after knowing what God has done, after knowing that your body is not just a body but an important vessel, important creation, so important that He was willing to give His only Son to die on the cross to redeem us. After knowing all this, Paul said, "Therefore, glorify God with your body." So how do we glorify God with our body? If I may suggest this, do not allow our body to be used in immorality, but instead use our body as a billboard, as a signage that points people to God. Keep our body healthy, eat right, exercise, get enough rest, because a body that is healthy performs best for the work that God has prepared for all of us. If we have a strong and healthy body, we can serve God more. What do we do now after knowing the value and importance of our body before God? Treat our body right. Give a high regard to our body in view of how God has done for us. We may not be practicing sexual immorality, but there are many indulgences, desires that sometimes we give our body into, that it brings harm than good to our health. Smoking, too much drinking, too much eating, no exercise. This will bring harm to our body. We may not feel the effect of it right now, but eventually it will come if you don't change your habit. You know, with a healthy body, we can better excel in life. We can look after our family and serve the purpose of God in our lifetime. Brothers and sisters, my hope and prayer as one body of Christ that we regard our body in the way that bring honor and glory to Him. As I end, please listen and meditate to this beautiful song.
To feel my hurt. the bright and morning star, would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart. Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. And you've told me who I am. I'm yours, I'm yours, I'm yours.
Who am I that the eyes that see my sin will look on me? Watch me rise again. Who am I that the voice that calmed the sea would call out to the rain and calm the storm in me? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are.
I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. And you told me who I am. I'm yours. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, you catch me when I'm falling, and you've told me who I am.
I'm yours, I'm yours.
Let's bow down our heads in prayer. Father, we thank you and we praise you for the body you gave us. Thank you for what you have done to demonstrate your love for us. Father, we pray that you may find us grateful by treating this body with right regard in the way that glorify and honor you. And may you find this vessel strong and healthy, always ready for what you want us to do. And I pray, Lord, that for the rest of our Transform series, may this program, may this campaign bring real transformation to each one of us. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, brothers and sisters. God bless you and see you next week.